gathered today to glorify your name. And give the pastor here the words that we need to hear, share with others. In your holy name, amen.
Good morning. Thank you for your flexibility. Tom and Tim had switched weeks for worship lead earlier in the week, but then I decided to ignore that and put Tom's name on the bulletin. So the bulletin has been just completely wrong. Vic, I don't even know why you handed it out. change the call to worship, not the call to worship, but change the scripture reading as we prepare for spending time with the Lord in His Word. And that's been kind of the theme over the last 36 hours. There's a saying among pastors, among preachers, that you never want to get up on Sunday morning and give them the Saturday night special. The thing that you've just kind of thought about Saturday night, and then you go ahead and just deliver that on Sunday morning. And I promise you that this is not the case, but the Lord, rather than changing my mind on Saturday night, did it on Sunday morning. So you're getting the Sunday morning special. But the reason for this change, I hope, will become clear as we progress through our time this morning. And I wanted to begin with a somewhat anecdotal story that I think will illustrate a truth that is important for us to understand as we consider the rest of our time together this morning. And I found a story, it just happened across one of my news feeds this week, and it's a great story, first of all. I mean, let me preface it by saying that, but there was a man who was, this is just in October of this past year, he's an assistant manager for the Vancouver Canucks hockey team. And they were playing in Seattle at the Seattle Kraken. They have a hockey team now, I think they're called the Seattle Kraken. It was the first home game for the Seattle Kraken. And so this assistant manager to the Canucks was on the bench for the Canucks, and a pre-med student of 22 years of age was behind him. And of course, she's just kind of scanning, watching the people that are close to her, and a mole on the back of his neck caught her eye. She says to herself that this mole is irregularly shaped, and it's rather large, and so knowing that this person is, you know, on the other side of plexiglass would probably be like, why are you trying to get my attention? She types in rather large font on her phone, knocks on the glass, gets him to turn around, and on her phone reads a message, the mole on the back of your neck looks to be cancerous. Please see a doctor. He, of course, just, shakes his head. His mind's on the game. He leaves the arena that night thinking to himself that was kind of strange, whatever, goes to sleep. Wakes up in the morning, but he's still thinking about it. He's thinking to himself, okay, maybe this is something. So he asks his wife to look at it. His wife looks at it and says, yeah, that does not look good. I think you should see a doctor. Well, the next day he was with the team again, and the team has a physician. And the team physician looked at that mole and said, absolutely, that is almost certainly cancer. And that doctor was able to remove it, send it off for biopsy, and it, sure enough, it came back as a melanoma. Very serious skin cancer. And thankfully, it was contained in the first couple layers of skin, so it had not gone into his system. But the doctor told him if that went unchecked for 4 to 5 years, he would be dead. And I love that story because, first of all, I love happy endings. If you're a Christian, you love happy endings. There are a lot of things about the future that give us pause, but we know for a fact that Jesus is coming back, and He will set all things new, and He's going to come back in a splendor of glory that we have never seen, and that we have a hard time putting to words and music, and that we're excited for what awaits us, because even amidst all of the uncertainty of what stands for Christians and the rest of the world, there is still that glorious truth that when He returns, that all things will be made right. And so I love happy ending stories, and this story is certainly one of them, but it's a picture that demonstrates love that is willing to tell the truth. Nowhere in this young lady's mind, a pre-med student, did she think to herself, first, I need to engage and get a relationship with this man, and then maybe he will trust me. No, she said, that mole looks cancerous. Please get it checked. I'm willing to say this to a complete stranger because there's this love that she has for someone she doesn't even know. And it's shocking to me in 2022 that in the country just to our north in Canada, that pastors are now deemed breaking the law if they do the same thing but to the higher extreme about warning about eternity. There's a law, and I'm going to call it an explosive law because it's known as C4. It's a C4 law, and it is exploding parts of Scripture. It is now commanding that in Canada, conversion therapy is deemed illegal. And they have loosely defined conversion therapy to now neuter Scripture and what a pastor can do legally in the pulpit. And I'd like to quote to you from their criminal code. The criminalization is happening when it's the words they use, causing another person to undergo conversion therapy, promoting or advertising conversion therapy. And the bill then defines conversion therapy as a practice, treatment, or service designed to change a person's sexual orientation to heterosexual, to change a person's gender identity to cisgender, to change a person's gender expression so that it conforms to the sex assigned to the person at birth, to repress or reduce non-heterosexual attraction or sexual behavior, to repress a person's non-cisgender identity, or reduce a person's gender expression that does not conform to the sex assigned to that person at birth. A very wide-ranging application of this law is going to be expected. And they continue, everyone who knowingly causes another person to undergo conversion therapy, including by providing conversion therapy to that other person, is guilty of an indictable offense and liable to imprisonment for a term of not more than 5 years. Similarly, everyone who knowingly promotes or advertises conversion therapy is guilty of an indictable offense and liable to imprisonment for a term of not more than 2 years. And it has been widely understood that that includes the pulpit. That in the pulpit, the expression of biblical marriage and sexuality is now illegal in Canada. It's shocking to me. That went into effect just this past week. And so today, right now at this very moment, brave pastors are standing in their pulpits and telling people that God has a better plan. And that he loves you enough to give you constraints. And he loves you enough to say that holiness matters. Because he desires holiness in his people. And pastors today will very likely face the first offense. And for some, it'll be the second time they have found themselves afoul of the law in Canada. Pastor James Coates and Pastor Tim Stevens, who spent a considerable amount of time in prison for keeping their churches open last year, are now prepared to go back to jail and continue their prison ministry, if so be it. Because God's standard and God's holiness is loving and merciful and kind. And it's a loving thing to warn people when they're in sin. It's a loving thing to warn of cancerous moles, which can cause your death, but to also warn of unrepentant sin, which can cost you your soul. And that's amazing to me that in 2022, that's just north of the border. Our time together this morning is not meant to be a screed. It's not meant to be an anger-filled rant. It's not meant even to be a push against any sort of ideology other than to promote what God's Word says and how we're called to live underneath God's Word in all of its constraints. And those began in the garden. In fact, if you're ever interested in starting a Christian ministry, I think that this could take off. The first parts of Genesis are very instructive to us. And I think that if you called your ministry Answers in Genesis, you might have something there. There are so many answers in Genesis. And turn with me, if you will, to Genesis 1. We have God in all of his splendor, calling forth the creation of all things. And in Genesis chapter 1, he gets to the creation of humans. And we get this special note of creation for humans. In Genesis 1:26, the Lord says, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth.'" Verse 27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them and blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." I mean, humankind is singled out from all of creation and given the special designation of bearing God's image. And we know from Isaiah that God is three times holy. He is holy, holy, holy. The only attribute to ever be repeated three times of the Lord is his holiness. And as we bear his image, that's what we are called to be. And as we went through 1 Peter, 1 Peter echoes what we hear in the Old Testament, that we are to be holy, for he who called us is holy. And this holiness is not exclusive to our sexuality. It's for all of our lives, isn't it? I mean, as the pandemic hit 2 years ago, we were in the middle of a series called Little Sins. And little, if you remember, was in the gigantic, bold, really big, humongous letters, because we have this idea that there are sins that are just so little that we don't have to worry about them. Like, I am so happy, you know, some people can think that, and maybe not anyone here. I'm so happy to hear a sermon where it talks about how homosexuality is a sin, but don't you dare touch my gluttony. Yes, amen, Pastor. Marriage is exclusive to one man and one woman. Yes and amen. But don't you dare talk about gossip. And that's what we were doing throughout that entire series. We were saying that holiness is important and encompasses all of our lives. And our sermon here this morning is not a response to call out one sin in particular, but to say that the government in Canada has absolutely extended and broadened and gone over the shores of their realm of authority. In no way, shape, form, in Canada, in Kenya, in Kansas, because I wanted to alliterate, can the government tell the church what it can or cannot say. The second that we bow to that is the second we are no longer a church. So we will continue to call for God's people to be holy. And the next time we have Young at Hearts at Ming 10 or 1010, we'll pray that we're not gluttonous. The next time that someone is gossiping to you, maybe you can step back and say, you know what? I don't want to participate in that because that sounds a lot like gossip. I think that that is gossip. I don't want to be a part of that sin. All of the sins. Not just the ones that the government says that we can and cannot say. And the second, you guys have this is what was going to be my charge. I'm going to issue it to you now. You guys have a charge as well. That the second that I curtail or curve what comes out of this pulpit based upon what the government says we can and cannot say, you are commanded to call for my resignation. Commanded. For the sake of my soul. Because I will have then abdicated my responsibility as a pastor and as a minister of the complete counsel of God's word. You are commanded to do that. Because at that point, I have been clouded in my judgment. And you have to call me to repentance and ask me to step down. Because God's word is authoritative over our lives. God's word is authoritative over your life in every respect. We talked this morning at an interesting amount of length about the word cherish. And I thought that was so important for us, because are we cherishing sins or are we cherishing God and the holiness in which we are meant to envision and image to those around us? And that word cherish, I thought, was helpful for us as we were thinking about the sins that were prevalent in the nation in Hosea's day. Because we have been created, male and female, in God's image, as he so richly expresses in Genesis 1. In Genesis 2 then even continues, God gives them some parameters as to what they can do and how they should live their lives. They can eat of every single tree of the earth and all the fruit thereof. But that one specific tree in Genesis 2 verse 17, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die. That was the warning to Adam that he was then supposed to convey to Eve. We got this whole beautiful garden at our disposal. We can eat of everything, but not of this one tree. And I had a youth group kid, as we were walking back to get on the bus yesterday on Wednesday, ask, why did God put that tree there? And I used an example that I said, you know, you've seen those videos where a parent puts the fruit snacks before their kid, and they say, I got to leave the room, and there's a camera going, but don't eat that until I come back. And it's like, you know, it's just an opportunity for us to show obedience. And it truly was an opportunity to worship God, to say, I trust you, God, that yes, that tree looks like it's delicious for food and for fruit and for sustenance so that I can be strong, so that we then, as a complementary relationship of Adam and Eve, can rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and of the animals on the land, that we can be fruitful and multiply, that looks like it would be delicious to eat, that would help sustain me, but God, I trust you with what everything else you've given me that I can enjoy. It's an opportunity to show obedience and to show that you trust the Lord. And there was an opportunity for Adam and Eve to flourish in that environment. Another question they asked at youth group on Wednesday was, okay, if Adam and Eve didn't sin, would the people after them have sinned? Like, well, we can't say for sure because it didn't happen. But, I mean, the next generation were killing each other. So I don't think they would have done any better. No. That's our... And sadly, our bent. But there is this guideline here. God has carved off something that looks good to the eyes, but is actually not good. And God says, show me obedience. I've given you one prohibition. Stick with it. Then in that account in Genesis 2 is that day 6 is kind of expanded for us in our understanding. In verse 21, we're starting to understand that Adam is alone, so this prohibition has been given to Adam, and he is to teach and to steward the prohibitions, and then, of course, the flourishing that the Lord has prescribed him to live in. And then we have the creation of woman and the giving of marriage. In verse 21 of Genesis 2, so the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And then the man said, this is at last bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. This is day 6. And Adam says, this is at last. He hadn't even been 24 hours without a companion, a complement, a helpmeet. He's excited that he has her. Be his companion, lifelong companion and complement, to be the strength where he has weaknesses, and that he can be the strength where she has weaknesses, and they can complement one another. And in verse 24, we hear the Lord saying, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. In this verse, we have God describing and prescribing the beautiful gift of marriage. I love this verse. This verse is instructive for us in many ways. Number one, it's the beginning of the picture of the relationship Jesus has with the church. So we're here even in the very beginning. We're getting a picture of Jesus and the church to come. And we also get the confines, the description of marriage, which is a man shall leave his father and his mother, leave his married unit, and hold fast to his wife, singular. This not only confines and describes marriage, but it also confines and describes what biblical sexuality and relationships look like. One man and one woman, not many. Not polyamory, not polygamy, but for life, to cling to his wife. Does not mean treat her as just the one that helps out around the house, to cleave and to cling to as one flesh. Not a separate entity anymore. One flesh. What a glorious union. Reliant and dependent upon each other. That's beautiful. It's glorious. And it's so easy, right, married people? No, because we also know Genesis 2 is not the end of Genesis. Genesis 3 is there for us to contend with. But marriage is created by God. It's ordained by God. It's defined by God. And this is before Israel. This is not a cultural expectation. This is a creation expectation. This is not for the nation of Israel. This is how Israel married. No, this was for all of creation. This was given to Adam and Eve. I've had the distinct privilege of performing two wedding ceremonies here. And if you ever see one on TV, they typically end with, by the powers vested in me, by the state of fill in the blank. State of Michigan has given me zero powers when it comes to marriage. And in those two wedding ceremonies that I've done, those words didn't come out of my mouth, because marriage is given and defined and authorized and ordained and blessed by God. And in fact, I am merely a facilitator in the participation and sharing and giving of vows of the bride to the husband and the husband to the bride. And when we closed those giving of the vows, I said, by the power vested in your covenant commitment to one another that you declared before the holy God, you are now pronounced husband and wife. Because the state of Michigan doesn't have squat to do with marriage, in my opinion. We'll sign the forms when we get done so you guys can do the whole, like, I'm filing my taxes married. But that's it. That's it when it comes to the state of Michigan and their authority over our marriages. What we do when we perform marriages at Dalton Community Church is we're instituting God's authority. And we're walking in the prescription that He has given to us. And it's two sinners coming together. Like, you know what happens when you multiply things? Like, they square, right? Like, 8 times 8. It's not 16. It's 64. Two sinners coming together in marriage. It's perfection, right, Kent and Dixie? Right, Neil and Kate? It's just easy, isn't it? I mean, you guys have, what, at least 8 or 9 years under your belt, right? Oh, it's hard. It's two sinners coming together, but we're doing so saying we're committed to one another. I had the privilege last 2 weeks ago to do a funeral for a gentleman who, for the last 21 years, had been sick in so many different ways, had strokes, had heart attacks, had diabetes. He had so many illnesses. The last 21, 22 years of his life were riddled with doctor's visits, hospital stays, surgeries, and everything else. And his wife said to me around the table as we were talking about how the next day was going to go, when I said, till death do I part, I meant it. And that was an encouragement to me. They weren't even saved. Like, take that to heart, Mike. As you profess to follow Christ, and you covenanted with Kathy. That was a challenge to me. But marriage has been created, ordained, and defined by God. And I have no power vested in me to declare that to you, but I'll help you facilitate that process as you covenant with one another before God. I wanted to look for a minute at Matthew 19, and this is an area where Jesus has quoted this exact text from Genesis 2. In Matthew 19, we've got our Lord being, he's towards the tail end of his earthly ministry. So his reputation is widely known. He's certainly garnered the attention of the Pharisees and the scribes who, from the very beginning of when they saw him, wanted to kill him. They wanted him dead. And so he knows that, and they're constantly laying traps for Jesus. And in Matthew 19, we see him moving into another region and being attempted to be trapped again. And in Matthew 19, verse 1, we read, "Now when Jesus had finished these sayings, he went away from Galilee and entered that region, the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And large crowds followed him, and he healed them there." Oh, look to be at that scene. Verse 3, "And Pharisees came up to him and tested him by asking, 'Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause?' Verse 4, Jesus answers, Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female, and said, therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. And then Jesus adds these beautiful words that are often read at a wedding ceremony. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. It gets no higher authority than from the words of our Lord Jesus Christ here. And within the context, let's first of all admit that this is absolutely talking about divorce. But Jesus moves beyond the allowance for divorce, which he calls because of your hard-heartedness and your stiff-neckedness, that God allowed Moses to issue a certificate of divorce. He moves beyond the nation of Israel, and he actually says, have you not read that from the beginning? Jesus took Genesis 1 and 2 literally. And he says that, no, from the very beginning, all creation has been given this call that marriage is uniquely defined. And it's defined by God. And in that union, there's enough tension with two sinners coming together. But in that union is where God blesses his people. God blesses them as they cling to one another. And as they do not separate, Jesus says, what God has joined together, let not man separate. So Jesus has now uttered the fact that this is a creation command, that this is God's authority, and that we're called to be loving in that regard, and to speak truth in that regard. Because it's God's authority. It's God's realm. It's God's right to tell us how that is confined within that realm and prescription of marriage. If you will, turn to Ephesians 5, and we'll see why Jesus and why God has prescribed it as such. I've already alluded to this already, that even back in Genesis 2, we're starting to see a picture of Jesus and the church, although they wouldn't have seen that back then. Paul lets us know that that was what was being played out before their very eyes. In Ephesians 5, verse 25, we have this beautiful picture then of what a marriage looks like as God has defined in Genesis 2. In Ephesians 5:25, husbands, pay attention. Not even Father's Day and I'm picking on you. Husbands, love your wives. Which you can, if there was a period there, you'd probably go, yeah, no problem, got it. You know, box of chocolates at Valentine's Day, and boy, she's good for a year. I might even remember her birthday and our anniversary. I'm loving my wife. I give her flowers, not even just on Sweetest Day, whatever that is. I'm loving her. I'm devoted to her. But there's not a period there at the end of husbands love your wives. There's a comma in the English anyways, and it goes on. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. How you doing, husbands? Tom chuckled, so I know he's with me. And Karen's not even near him, so I know he didn't get elbowed. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Why do we want to protect marriage? Because it's a picture of Christ and his church. As Christ gave himself up for her. There was so much going on at the cross that our sins were being paid for, and that Christ was building the church that he promised that the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And he was giving himself up so that people could be saved and brought into this right relationship with him and brought into the church universal, the church global, we can say, the church throughout all time, that your church members with those people that we read about through church history and in your scriptures, they aren't part of a different church, that they're part of the church universal, but that, yes, it also includes the local body as we are obedient to him and the word. So So husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Husbands, your role may not be predominantly to sanctify your wife, but if you aren't also being sanctified, how are you participating in that call? I think your own sanctification is on the table at that point. Verse 28, in the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. That almost sounds selfish. But you're one flesh union. You may have separate bodies, but you are one flesh. Her body is just as much yours as yours is hers. That you care for her, you love her, you dote on her, you cherish her, you sacrifice for her, you lay down your wills and your desires for hers, and vice versa. What a beautiful relationship that could be. But that's what Christ did for the church, isn't it? And think of all the times that Jesus demonstrated that beautiful, challenging principle. I mean, the night of his death, he took on the role and uniform of a servant and washed feet, of all things. Now, husbands, don't go run home and wash your wife's feet, unless you want to, and she thinks that that's a great idea, but that's really a beautiful picture of sacrificial love, that nothing's off the table, that you give for one another, that you sacrifice for one another. And if it wasn't even clear enough, Paul then in verse 31 continues, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And then Paul, in blatant transparency, says, this mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. That's what your marriage pictures, husbands and wives, if you're married. You're Christ in the church. Now that by no means means that the men now get some Messiah complex, unless you understand the Messiah of Scripture and know that he sacrificially loved. Challenging things, but oh, so critically important for us. It leads me to ask the question, specifically in the case of Canada. And the reason why I want to talk about it this morning is because I don't want to wait for it to happen here. Is, have we rendered unto Caesar that which is God's? In Matthew 22, verses 21 and 22, Jesus is approached about a question about taxes, and he answers that question. He's like, well, pay your taxes according, of course. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. Implying, render unto God what is God's. Have we rendered unto Caesar that which is God's? And have we already set the stage for our own fall? By the power vested in me, by the state of Michigan? There are realms of authority, to be sure. And in both Romans 13:3 and in 1 Peter 2, we know that government has been given its realm of authority to be a terror to bad conduct, or we could say evil, to be a terror to evil and to promote and to support and to encourage good. And we are now seeing that there's a broad umbrella over all of creation, and it is the Lord's, all of it. The tsunami that may hit the West Coast today, that's under God's authority. The missionaries in Cuba who were kidnapped and held for ransom and somehow released out of a miraculous escape, that was under God's authority. But when you start to see governments formally move outside of their prescribed authority, which is to be a terror to evil and to be a promoter of good, that's where we as Christians, we do not render unto Caesar that which is God's. They have been given the sword to help protect, to help even in the case of war, to help protect in the case of inside of our own countries for policing and for the keeping of peace. And they have no authority whatsoever over this. And as long as I am of sound mind, it'll never happen here. Because I love Jesus too much to give up his bride. I love you too much to tell you that everything is fine and you're going to heaven if you are in unrepentant sin. All sins. Drunkenness. Gossip. Slander. I'll just tell you why my eyes are welling up, and I wasn't planning this, I never do. But we take sin seriously. I take sin seriously. And we battled for Tony's life because drunkenness is a sin. He fought for his life because he knew drunkenness was a sin. And he battled for it. Which is why I'm convinced that he is in heaven today. Because he was warring against the sin. And we're never once guaranteed perfect victory like a light switch. I prayed that for Tony. I prayed that God would just take that addiction from him, but he didn't. And I leave that in the mystery and the providence and the sovereignty of God. We take sin seriously because souls matter. If a pre-med student sees a mole on the back of a neck of an opposing team's coach or the manager and says, I love you too much to let that cancer take your life, I gotta say something. How foolish are we to shut our mouths about this also important topic? And we love people too much. We speak the truth in love. If this ever gets seen online for any strange reason by more than 6 people, so be it. But if comments come in and pastor is fill-in-the-blank ophobe, or he's hating, then they're putting that on me, not me coming out of my mouth. Because I love you too much to see unrepentant sin exist. And I start with my own heart. There are Sundays when we have communion that I don't take communion. Because I know I've given sins at times in my heart safe harbor. And I say, I can't go before the Lord at this point and say that I'm right with you, God. Even though I know I'm positionally right with God, I'm saved, I'm declared righteous, not in and of my behavior, but circumstances be what they were, angry with the kids or shout with anger at in traffic or whatever the case, I haven't guarded my heart. And I say to myself, I can't take, that's me, that's on me. It's not for you guys to, I have to do that too. But I've been convinced at times to not take the Lord's Supper because of that. Because we take sin seriously, and it starts in my own heart. And I'll do my best from this pulpit to not be a hypocrite. But please know that every single sermon I've ever preached has come from the lips of a sinner. But a sinner who is redeemed and saved by a forgiving and loving God. And it's the same God I appoint all of you to every Sunday. Because he is victorious. When you're battling that sin and you can't get through the next day, then get through the next minute. Fight for that next minute. Don't roll over and let it have you. Pray. Reach out to someone. Read scripture. Pastor, those are Sunday school answers. You're right, because I think what we teach in Sunday school is right and true. Reach out to people. There's not a single time that I've committed sin in my life where if I would have stopped and thought for a second, prayed to God, and even reached out to somebody if I felt vulnerable enough to be able to say, I am struggling in this area and I'm ready to do this, where I would have been left, where I would have then committed the sin. God gives us victory. And we're engaged in the fight. We're engaged in the battle. And we fight for holiness because God is holy, holy, holy. And we're called to be holy because the one who called us is holy. And we fall short daily, but his mercies are new every single morning. And let me ask you right now on this earth, is there any place where it's not morning? Yeah. No, it's morning somewhere, everywhere. That morning is just constantly moving around our globe. Your mercies are new always, every single morning that you start your, I work third shift. Well, then your morning's in the afternoon. Stop trying to find a way out of it. His mercies are new every morning. Go to him. Flee to the throne of grace. Turn away from the lies of Satan and the perversions of Satan and run to Jesus. Because he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Cleanse you. You're not cleansing yourself. You're not hopping in the bathtub. You're going to Jesus and saying, take this from me, please. Give me victory, at least right now. And he won't turn you away. He won't turn you away. 1 Corinthians 6. I like this passage for a time such as this. Because there's a very hopeful tone to what Paul's hammering the Corinthian church about. Paul is absolutely, Ephesians 5, 4:15, he's speaking the truth in love here. In Ephesians 6, verses 9 through 11, let me read. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. That's a strong warning for Paul. Don't be deceived, which means deception is out there. It's in here, it's out there. Neither the sexually immoral, lest you think we were just speaking about one topic here. Sexually immoral, and as the Bible describes sexual morality, it's anything outside of the confines of marriage. You're hooking up. I feel bad for our youth as they are pushed into this hookup culture where, as it was even in our day, where, you know, the more conquests you have, the more of a man you are, the more cool you are as a girl. No! It's immorality. That's sin. Save yourself for the beautiful confines of marriage. What a beautiful gift you can give to your future spouse. And guess what? If that's already, if you've already fallen in that area, God can forgive you. Our kids are pushed into the fact that sexuality is in everything, in our movies, in our music. It's described in interesting ways in music. And it's available for free on the internet in disgusting form. So do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy. Uh-oh, we're getting to be this. Net's getting pretty wide, Paul. Nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And I guarantee you, in the church in Corinth, everyone was in his sights. He wasn't picking on anybody. He was promoting the Lord's holiness. And then verse 11, so good. And such were some of you. God rescues. God delivers. God gives hope. God can take what we cherish that's wrong and evil and sinful and falling deceit to the lies of Satan, did God really say, and help us battle those. And your battle may be quick. God may give you victory really quick. I know many stories like that. But I also know many stories where people are still in the fight today. God gives victory. Today, right now, in the future, battle it. Fight it. Because such were some of you. This is not a holier-than-thou speech. This is a such am I and was I. And we battle and we war because God and Christ is worth it. Such were some of you. I changed the sermon or the scripture reading to Psalm 27 and threw it at Tim at the door. Really planned ahead this morning. And in Psalm 27, I think we see David engaged in this battle in an entirely different way, but I think applicable to us this morning. Psalm 27, verse 1, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? He certainly had bodily fear and safety on his mind. But how many of us today fall to the fear of peer pressure, to what culture says is appropriate, or what the government says is legal? The Lord is my light and my salvation. I follow him. Underneath his umbrella do I dwell. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my stronghold, is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Oh, for conviction like that in you all and in me. When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. I prayed that this morning for the pastors in Canada as they're preaching the truth of God's word and the victory and deliverance that comes through Jesus Christ. That though an army encamp against them, that they will still preach truth because eternity matters. If anyone's going to go to hell, let them go. With us grabbing their ankles saying no, let we be like Jude and try to snatch them from the flames and say no, there's a better way. Verse 4, one thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. We dwell, we gaze, and don't miss inquire. God, I have these affections, and I'm hearing from the word that these aren't right. I'm inquiring of you to help me with them, Lord. Humble me and help me to seek more of you. God, when I pick up the bottle, I can't put it down until I'm drunk. Help me, Father, to fight that so that I'm not losing control of myself. Help to preserve my witness for you. Father, when I hear some juicy gossip, I just got to get on Facebook into my private messengers and tell three people. Help me to fight that, Father, because that's gossip and I wouldn't want anyone talking like that about me. And don't chuckle, God, when I go to 10:10, I want plates 3 and 4. My satisfaction comes from you. And your daily bread. And your new mercies. Because I'm a sinner. And I had lots of adjectives that are described in many of the lists in Scripture. But such was I. And such were some of you. Flee to Jesus. Into his loving, caring, protective, healing, and future-pointing arms. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we trust you, Lord, with what your word says. Father, we trust you with our hearts and our affections. Father, so often we talk about these things, and sometimes they're light and jovial, but Father, these are dear and dire aspects of our lives. You've created us as willing, feeling, emotional, desirous beings, because we're meant to feel so good in your presence. We're meant to desire so much of you as you've shown us through your word. So much so, Father, that you've given us your Holy Spirit to convict us in those matters and to lead us into righteousness and to make us long for more of Christ. Lord, I'm thankful that in your word you tell us that we need to mortify these sins, that we need to crucify ourselves daily, not literally, Lord, but die to ourselves daily so that we see that our desires at times can be led astray and that we want more of you. Father, so much of this falls down into the realm of vulnerability and pride. Lord, so often we aren't vulnerable with you. We guard parts of our hearts, lying to ourselves as if they're off limits and you can't see them. But Father, you know us better than we even know ourselves. So Lord, may we lay ourselves before you, trusting that you can lead us, heal us, do the surgery that's necessary, at times painful. But we don't do it alone. We do it with one another in the church, supporting us. And Father, best of all, we do it with the Holy Spirit. Communion with Christ and fellowship with the Father, so that you, Lord, get all the glory. Father, we love you and we thank you for your life-giving word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.